Hello friends, today we have with us a very interesting personality. He is Managing Director and CEO for Mahindra Electrical and Mobility Limited. We have with us Mahesh Babu. Mahesh ji, welcome to the discussion.
Thank you.
So Mahesh ji, today we will like to focus our discussion on auto industry and what will be the scenario of auto industry in post-COVID world. Currently, as you are aware, auto industry is showing degrowth. So what you think will be the size of auto industry, or what will be the auto industry in post-COVID world, sir?
I think firstly, I would say auto industry has been going through a lot of disruption in the recent past. I would say it is for the good because it brings in efficiency and also brings in value to the customer. So if you look at auto industry, I think India auto industry is very critical because it's almost 7% of the GDP of India. And particularly in manufacturing, it's almost close to 50%. So it plays a very vital role in, I would say, the economy engine running in the country in a smooth way. Now, having said that, I think COVID has posted some challenges, particularly with respect to March. I think we had a challenge of unprecedented scale, which industry has not seen, or I would say humanity has not seen for a century, I would say. So this has posed us many questions, but also it has taught us many lessons. The lessons learned the industry has taken, I would say, is about many things, myth, which we had that we have to do it by face to face. We could able to do it without even meeting each other in a very, very technological way. The way in which Dr. Yu and me are talking today, in a very similar platform, I think technology has enabled many things to happen to a pleasant surprise. So I would say industry, auto industry has embraced a new way of working in this period. How to make it, except the physical production, I think we could able to do many drawings, development, releases, many things when we are sitting.
So how much of your workforce is working offline, sir, or working from home?
Almost more than 70% of our workforce right now working from home. If you ask me, week back, it was 100%. So last week we started our plant and we just, with a very minimal number, 20% manpower, we are just trying to cope it. Coming back, I think the COVID situation has given us chance to revisit our business model, revisit our products, revisit our way of work, and revisit the whole business by itself, I think. And it's not going to be the same way we used to do business pre-COVID. I feel personally that post-COVID, the life is not going to go back to the same way. And industry is also not going to go back to the same way. And hence, we have to look at efficient way of manufacturing, efficient way of time utilization of executives, particularly meetings and decision making and so on, which we have learned in last 40 days. I think it has made us more efficient. Now, looking forward, how it will look like, I think there are some challenges on public mobility for a short term, while the industry will look at cash for the next 3 months. Over a period of time, we'll have to look at cash growth and life, and then market share and many more things like that. And hence, it is important that we now look at the way of doing business. The way of doing business, you can look at what Mahindra has recently announced, as recently as yesterday, the digital form of experiencing in buying a car, and many more things like that. I'm sure all the industry experts will follow and do very similar digital way of buying a car. I think the customer's preference over the features and things like that will change. And hence, we need to revisit the complete customer value proposition and redefine the way the products are today designed post-COVID. Having said that, there are shoots saying that the personal mobility will increase because many of them would not like to step into public transport till we get confidence on hygiene and social distancing for a short period. And hence, people may move to two-wheelers and cars, personal cars for a short term.
But so you see, this is a silver lining in this, that because people would like to maintain social distancing, they will be more towards, they will be keen on using their own vehicles, and actually the sales of cars eventually will go up?
I think so. I think so. That's the hypothesis most of us are right now looking at. But having said that, will we get the sales as quickly as where we were, like a V-shaped curve? We need to look over a period of 3 months and see how does it open up, because it also depends on how the economy opens up. Looking at what's happening right now, we are opening up in a phased manner. When we open up in a phased manner, I'm sure economy is going to build up over a phased manner. Mobility is going to be the need over a phased manner. There are certain things which are permanently going to change. I think work from home is going to be a way of life for many IT, many office going jobs for a pretty long time. Now, this has posed a challenge of need for mobility. At the same time, this also, as I said, has opportunity for personal mobility opportunity. So we'll have to look at overall what it looks like. But what Indian auto industry, I believe, and particularly, let's say, new technologies like electric vehicles, it gives us a good opportunity with what government is saying today on particularly Make in India. I think the complete global supply chain disruption due to COVID on auto and as well as on electric vehicle has given us a lot of thought process what we need to do going forward.
But Mahesh, with the oil prices going sub-zero, or maybe eventually they will end up hovering around $30-$35 a barrel, do you think that e-mobility will have traction in long run, sir?
See, you'll have to look at crude prices and you have to look at pump prices. I think you are talking about crude prices. Looking at the pandemic and the challenges government across the world are facing, I don't think anybody is going to give oil free to consumers, and they are going to tax it heavily. You have seen already India. India is looking at fiscal deficits, and hence most of the things have to be relooked in a tax perspective. So I don't believe oil will be cheaper at the pump level. So it is not going to be cheaper. Even if you look at, let's say, 50% cheaper, what you are talking about, the operational cost difference between electric and fossil fuel is not just in few percentage. If you are 70 paisa per kilometer is your operating cost for EV, it's going to be 4.5 rupees, 5 rupees for a gasoline or a diesel. So this can never be bridged just because EVs are just four times efficient than fossil fuel. So you can't make it so efficient so quickly, and hence it is not practically possible. So given a chance, EV is always the most efficient way next to walking for any mobile application. So I think it will take a longer time for that. And hence still EVs will do a better way. I think there are a lot of things which we have seen, how Delhi has become suddenly clean air. You could able to see Himalayas for a very long distance and so on and so forth, has given awareness among people. And hence, when we go back or when we start our new life post-COVID, most of us will think, do we want to do the same way like pre-COVID, or do we want to see, look at what we want to contribute to the society, what we want to contribute to the environment, and do we look at the new ways of living? Because today, most of the vehicles are needed because you would suddenly travel weekend to a 500 kilometer range. With the COVID, post-COVID situation, it's not going to be there. Most of the time, you're going to be in city and you're going to be in a very short distance. Then EV fits in perfectly well in such scenarios. So this is going to change the whole dynamics of it. But however, having said that, we have to be flexible and dynamic and agile to make sure to understand what customer needs, create products to meet those customers, and make sure that the value contribution comes to the country, Make in India, are the three things I would say we have to do when post-COVID.
So Maheshji, Prime Minister is talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat. If you really look at e-mobility, the biggest and the most expensive component of e-mobility or e-vehicles is the lithium batteries. And we are not making lithium batteries in this country. So how this Atmanirbhar Bharat concept will go with e-mobility, sir?
See, I think you have a valid point. How do we go reach to the goal of complete value chain participation by India? The challenge would be lithium-ion battery. But look at the value proportion. Let's say, let's look at an EV vehicle. Let's take an EV car. Almost 70% of the value comes from electrical components, EV components. Out of the 70, let's say 30% comes from cell. Most of us are so paranoid on cell, and we left the remaining 40% away. There are motors, motor controllers, power electronics, inverters, software and embedded system, which is the vehicle control unit and battery management system. All of them needs localization. In Mahindra, if you ask us today, the Treo, which is the three-wheeler which we are selling, except the cell, everything else is localized. The motor is made in-house. In India, the motor controller is made in India, the power electronics DC-DC converter is made in India, the charger is made in India, the whole vehicle is made in India, the battery pack is made in India, the battery management system is made in India, except the cell, which is the 30% value. Now, are we going to do this across the sector in EV and IC? We will have to look at it. Of course, India, I know very clearly there is a battery and energy storage mission announced by Niti Aayog. And I was told that government is very actively looking at supporting that mission to set up lithium-ion battery manufacturing in India. I think it is not only for EVs, but also look at your own mobile phones. Today, you are holding right. Mobile phones, computers, so many IT devices. All the batteries comes from abroad. So why can't we do that? I think this is the time we have to, as a country, sit down and see how can you play a value chain of globally rather than just talking about supplying to India. The right question to ask is how can we set up a state-of-the-art lithium-ion manufacturing in India to supply to the globe rather than saying that when do we localize lithium-ion cell?
So whether Mahindra is taking steps in that direction, sir?
Yes. So, except the cell, let me explain the other things. We are setting up.
And I would also, and because we are continuing this, this is a very interesting discussion. So, just I would like to also add, because you are talking about the entire value chain, sir. If you can also eventually add about what kind of startup opportunities are available for youngsters in this sector.
So in the first question, I'll explain what Mahindra is doing. For example, we are investing and setting up a new state-of-the-art plant in Pune, which will make motors, motor controllers, battery management system, power electronics, battery pack and battery module, except the cell. The whole technology is going to be made in our own plant. And we are not making it just for us. It is going to be supplied in India. Already, we have got two firm orders, one for Korea and one for Europe already, supplying such EV technology to them in coming years. So, and we are going to go and get many more customers. So we are looking at being a value chain on EV, not just for India, but looking at across. Now, having said that, do we want to get into lithium-ion cell manufacturing? Yes, we want to be enablers and partner with somebody because it also needs an investment, right? So we have to invest in many things, and we are happy to partner with somebody to the lithium-ion cell as well. Now, coming to startups. Startups, I think, are playing a very vital role already on EV on the front end. There are many startups who have come on, who have started giving employee transport on electric mobility, starting a last mile delivery connectivity on EV. Even startups are talking about last mile delivery of goods through electric three-wheelers, four-wheelers, and small commercial electric vehicles. So there are a lot of front-end areas are possible to be, I would say, innovated with a cost-effective new technology-based manner to deliver what we have to deliver to customers. There are huge startups who are there, and I think India's strength is that. But my worry is there are no startups who are doing technology. I think somewhere in India, the basic science and basic technology is not seen as a startup. I think we need to look at how can we make a startup motor company. because it needs investment, and it's very difficult to go and get venture capital for a motor company. They will say the motor company, there are a lot of guys running around, and it's very difficult to differentiate it needs. That's where Government of India has to play a role in enabling technology-based startups. How do we invest? How do we collaborate? How do we enable? And things like that, and how such technology-based. There are a lot of things to be done on battery management system. There are a lot of things to be done on motor and motor controller efficiencies and cost and optimization and many more. Battery packs and even cell manufacturing. Cell manufacturing, cell, if you want to be a global supply chain on cell, without an R&D, without the base technology cooperation, you will be just become a manufacturing location. Which is, I would say, not sustainable in a, what I would say, country perspective. Country needs to develop IPRs. Country needs to develop process by ourselves. Of course, learning from global technologies. So this is what we have to look at. And there is a huge opportunity, I believe, in technology as well.
But sir, when it comes to especially lithium-ion batteries, India hardly has any lithium ores. Majority of them are in Bolivia, Australia, and even in China. So in long run, do you really believe that e-mobility based on lithium-ion batteries is the real future for us? Or we have to look into technologies like thorium and other technologies, similar technologies, sir?
See, I would suggest we should look at batteries as storage devices. Now, if you go up the ladder and think lithium ion today chemistry was derived based on the challenges faced by storage in consumer electronics and many more, including electric vehicles. Now, how did this happen? Because there was lead acid, then came lithium ion, then nickel-based, cobalt-based, manganese-based, now many more. Now, today we have NMC. Yes. The most preferred chemistries and most invested chemistries across the world. But it's not going to be the end. Lithium is also recyclable. More than 70% we can recycle and get impact. And percentage of lithium available on a cell is also not very high. So we'll have to look at the future. If you look at future, sometime back, cobalt was a very big requirement. Today, people are talking cobalt-less chemistries. People will talk about aluminium air batteries, people are talking about storage devices with multiple chemistries. I don't think today we should be too much worried that any particular iron ore or any ore is going to dominate it. The ecosystem of today around the world, which is working on storage, is much beyond lithium ions. People are talking about solid state batteries, silicon based, nanotechnologies, and many more. I'm sure every 5 to 10 years you will see a new chemistry coming. And hence, instead of debating too much on what we will do, I think we should start thinking about how do we handle our energy storage technology in India.
I think you are fair in your comments. Sir, currently due to this COVID crisis, world is pretty annoyed with China, the way they handled it. And China is has a huge influence on automobile sector across the globe. So, sir, do you think that this will eventually open space for India and Indian automobile industry on the global platform, sir?
See, I think India, on a global scale, was already very participative in auto industry. Of course, China was also very aggressive in investing in many outside China on auto sector. But India was very fairly participating in the global supply chain, whether it is automotive components or it is exporting vehicles. We were doing a fair bit of a chance. Now, China, when the whole world is now looking at a new supply chain phenomenon, changeover phenomenon, I think India has to play well. I think that is what is important. We'll have to look at our labor laws. We'll have to look at our judiciary system. We'll have to look at our land laws. We'll have to look at the benefits of how fast and how comfortably industry can be open and protected in this place. If the government is looking at all this, which I am seeing from the Prime Minister's speech recently, I think it will help many foreign investors to come and look at actively India's as an option in the global supply chain. But I would tell you, we have to work a lot. We'll have to not only give confidence, I think on the ground, working with state and central government are very, very important, because we are a federal country. While the central government gives a thing, I think industry, land and all that is very twinned with the state government. And hence, if we utilize, see, I can say there is an opportunity. If the country wants to utilize it, I think it is all in our hands.
So the final question I would like to ask, because we work with MHRD and I am Chief Innovation Officer for MHRD, and we work with large number of students and technical institutions. So what kind of technical competencies now youngsters should develop to remain or to keep themselves relevant in this emerging auto sector, especially in the post-COVID world, sir?
See, I think there are a lot of things we need to do on skill development. Today, the education system, particularly on engineering, whether it is mechanical, automobile or electrical, I think it is aimed towards more domain individual knowledge. If you look at an automobile today, it is no more than mechanical engineering. Earlier, mechanical engineers used to be dominating the auto industry. Today, if you look at it's all software and embedded, guys. Now, India being a strong IT and software and embedded knowledge base, where we lack, and I think most of them ask this very legitimate question to me when they come here, they ask me, look at the world. Bangalore has like a Silicon Valley as the IT capital. And you guys have so much IT capital in India. You have so much automobile industry in India. But the autonomous vehicles, EV vehicles, and other vehicles which are integrating those knowledge base comes not from India, but from outside India. I think what is needed now is mostly integration skill knowledge, employability, and skill development is very important than just the domain deep knowledge of individuals. I think if you ask me now, I think there has to be a curriculum mixing electrical, mechanical, software, and kind of, while there may be an importance in one particular area, people or the students must know the other areas in a very, what I would say, very natural way when they come out. The second one I strongly believe is soft skills. I think India lacks on soft skills. We so much focus on the knowledge base and technology and all that. We need to also bring in soft skills. Most of the times that is going to help to adapt in industry pretty fast. And I think if we do this domain integration on technology based on develop soft skills, the skill development, the engineers would be able to be doing a great job in across the world.
I think, sir, let's close down on this optimistic note, where I believe that students will listen to your suggestions on developing soft skills. Thanks for joining. Thanks for sparing time. We sincerely appreciate, sir. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. It was a pleasure talking to you, Doctor.